Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. familiar with the music of Marvin Hatley as it applies to the background music, background songs that we hear Vince Giordano play all the time, and that you heard outside played by Ronnie Hazelhurst. But what we'd like to give you tonight is a little sampling of the songs that were featured in some of the Laurel and Hardy films. I think probably my favorite song out of any Laurel and Hardy film was sung in Pardon Us. It was called Lazy Moon. It was written in the early 1920s. It was in the style of the old minstrel ballads. And as such, was generally performed in blackface and with a sort of a derisive characteristic dialect. Babe sang in blackface in a picture track. I'm going to forgo the dialect in the blackface and offer you, hopefully, your pleasure, Lazy Moon. Now, if you recall the setting, it is dusk. The field hands are relaxing after a long day's toil. And the sky is being searched for the light of the moon to provide light for the strolls down the river's bank.
Lazy moon, come out soon. Make my poor heart beat warmer. Light the way, bright as day, for my sweet little charmer. Now she's to meet me in the lane tonight. If the sky is bright and clear, oh moon, don't keep me waiting here tonight. Watching and awaiting, heart a palpitating, longing for my little lady love. Lazy moon, lazy moon, why don't you show your face upon the hill? Lazy moon, come out soon. You can make me happy if you will. Now when my lady sees your face a-peeping, then I know her promise she'll be keeping. Tell me what's the matter, are you sleeping? Lazy moon.
Hey, I didn't know you could sing. In fact, I'm still not convinced. Tell me something, Ray. Just when did you learn to sing? How did that accident come about? What are you going to do, put down with it? That's my job. How can you ever sing? Hey, who's working his head? I just hope they're wearing rubber gloves. That's all I got to say. Hey, are you? Keep it to yourself. All right.
What you must know, I had an accident when I was a kid. I was in bed. I didn't have anything else to do, so I learned how to sing. I was flat on my back.
Ready? Or are you still flat? And I mean that from the bottom of my body.
Thank you. Gone. Another great Laurel and Hardy song was sung in Bohunks.
Wait a minute. Wait. Time out. Time out.
What are you doing?
Time borrow.
No.
Time out.
21.
I thought that we were going to be celebrating the music at Halloween Studios tonight.
We are. What do you think I'm doing?
Well, I don't know, but all I've heard so far is about the music.
Well, we respect.
That was Laurel and Hardy.
We're the sons of the desert. We're here to celebrate Laurel and Hardy.
But what about Charlie Chase?
What about Charlie Chase?
Well, I mean, he was a great singer and a dancer as well.
Look, Stanley, we will all respect. When I think of Charlie Chase, I think of 10 minutes. One reel in the middle of the film that gave our organization its name, Sons of the Desert.
Somehow we're a historian, you are.
Not a historian.
Listen, how many films of Laurel and Hardy sing and dance in?
Exactly.
Yeah,
exactly. I don't know.
Well, something like 4, not counting 3. Kevin, help.
4, not counting 3.
Well, Charlie Chase sang in over 20 films. He sang about 27 songs in 20-some-odd films, and he danced in about 15. Okay, and as Vice President of the Sons of the Desert, I feel it's my prerogative and privilege to show some of you the genes of the musical artist you, Charlie Chase.
All right, Stanley, what are these dozens of songs, what are these examples you have to demonstrate this genius and also hopefully entertain our audience at the same time?
Are you kidding? was a lot like Elvis Presley.
Wait a minute.
No, but it's right on. Because Charlie Chase and Elvis Presley would sing a song at any given moment about anything at any given time. For instance, he was teaching the Little Rascals one time. He was a teacher. Now, a normal teacher who was teaching mathematics would just teach about mathematics. But would Charlie Chase teach mathematics only?
No.
Listen to this one. He not only taught mathematics to the kids, but he gave them a lesson in life as well. 1 times 1 equals only 1. But 1 and 1 are 2. And a simple thing like a wedding ring will prove this most untrue. 'Cause if you add 1 to another 1, pretty soon they'll multiply. And the 2 you see will soon be 3 if the 2 dear are you and I. Hi, hi.
Hi, hi.
If the 2 dear are you and I. Now, normally, someone will propose to another, but would Charlie Chase just...
I'm already
married. Well, I'm happy to marry too.
Okay.
And we just propose. But would Charlie Chase just propose?
No.
Charlie Chase, when he was courting Rosina Lawrence in a particular film, sang a song to her while he was courting her. He sang this to her. Listen, dear, have you got a date tomorrow? If you haven't, I'll make a date with you. Promise, dear, that you won't be late tomorrow. We'll have an awful lot of things to do. So get to bed and get a lot of rest. 'Cause tomorrow you will want to look your best. Let's make it a big day. We'll start out at 9:30, do things in a big way. First, I'll ask you to be mine. And when your pa has cussed us and your ma has said okay, we'll hurry to the justice, do our shopping right away. Don't overlook a thing, get a wedding ring and a platinum one at that. I'll get my trousers pressed, get a fancy vest and a brand new derby hat. We'll make a payment on a wedding gown. We might as well hire a plaid, so what do you say? Let's make it a big day.
Shot.
They come in from the stable and I put them on the spot. The baby's in a little cradle, tucked in nice and tight. And I'm in the doghouse and I can't go out tonight. At the end of the night, and there is Felix Knight.
The Jack in the Box, that's great. Stan, you're absolutely right, Charlie Chase, from any man who could go before a collective audience of 50 million Americans and sing songs like that and remain on contract has got to be more than an average talent. I agree.
I am really not done. In all seriousness, yes, most of Charlie Chase's songs were silly. Most of his films came out in the Depression. And while Charlie Chaplin in 1936 was preaching about smiling,
I knew he'd get Chaplin in there!
Charlie Chase was preaching about smiling during despair of the Depression 6 years before.
Smile when the raindrops fall, dear. Smile till the clouds roll by. Just remember that I love you, though dark is the blue, blue sky. Dark clouds will fade away, dear. Soon pass beyond recall. So just smile at the skies with those big smiling eyes. Just smile when the raindrops fall. So just smile at the skies with those big smiling eyes. Just smile when the raindrops fall.
Come the last one first, we would have to go through the first. You may, okay, now what are we gonna do next? I'd like to introduce someone who is, he's going to tell us, he's going to explain to us the reason for the durability of the Hal Roach music. We have with us tonight one of the world's foremost musicologists.
And here I am.
And you are?
Tone deaf.
Well, there must be some mistake. I'm expecting a musicologist here this evening.
You're in spitting distance from him. That's me. I'm a musicologist. I am tone deaf.
How can you be a musicologist if you're tone deaf?
Because that's my name, you stupid ex-president.
That's his name. Well, fine, then, Professor Tone Deaf. Very good. Now, as I understand it, Professor...
Aren't you glad to meet me? Don't you?
I'm very glad to meet you.
Yeah, it's a real pleasure to meet you, too.
I'd like to shake cigars, thank you. Now, as I understand, Professor,
right.
You are here this evening
so am I.
To tell us about the reason for the durability and the success of the music, Hal Roach Studio.
Oop, funny you should mention that. That's why I'm here. You see, I've been researching this phenomenon ever since I completed my dysentery on the boogie-woogie and its evolutionary effects on society.
Dysentery? You mean dissertation?
All I know is I was sick as a dog by the time I finished that thing.
All right, if you would please just tell our audience about the music of Hal Roach Studios, Professor Tone Deaf.
Is he here too? Oh, that's me! Thank you very much. You see, the most significant aspect of the compositions which emanated from the Hal Roach Studios was the simplistic nature of the harmonic and counterpunctual interstab infections, which of course created a psychological and physiological reactive response affinity on the part of the patrons who experienced the cinematic consecration of the multi-leveled optical audio components in the exhibition area. Thank you very much.
Now, what the hell does all that mean?
The people liked it.
Well, we know they liked it. What we want to know is why did they like it?
Oh, there you go, getting metaphorical with me, are you? And you know, I never met a four I didn't like. Let me talk about this thing here. We know the reason they liked it. Because they was happy little tunes that went deedle dide deedle. They wasn't complicated symphonies that went boom-pa, boom-pa, boom-pa. Matter? If you take a music that goes deedle-dide-deedle, or you play it with a moving picture that has deedle-dide papers, you not only get harmony in music, you get harmony in pictures.
Just a minute, Professor. I think I follow you. I just have one question.
Yeah?
What are deedle-dide peoples?
Oh, I'm so disappointed in you. You know, deedle-dide peoples, like those rascal gangs. Un Oliver and Hardy. Un Charlie made the glasses on the ski nose who sings too darn many songs as far as I'm concerned. Mit them goes deedle-dide-deedle music. You wouldn't play deedle-dide-deedle music with Lionel Barrymore or Orson Welles, would you? No, mit them you play boom-pa, oom-pa, oom-pa. In the rascal games, you play deedle-dide-deedle.
Okay.
Und so, then you have deedle-dide music mit deedle-dide peoples, and you put them both in deedle-dide pictures, you get boom-pa, oom-pa box office. And that's big bucks. That makes the boys in the front orifice very happy. Oh boy, you get 7-year contracts. You get a Spanish bungalow with a swimming pool on Mulholland Driveway. Oh, you get a front table in a Romanoff's. You get your name in Luella Parsons' column once a week. Bunch of ventures spread malicious lies about your sex life on the front pages of every radio across the continent. It's a rotten, stinking business.
Professor.
I hate it.
Professor.
And why do I do it for that?
Professor.
What deedle, deedle, deedle. Hey, why do we sit here talking about this trivia and there's bombs going off in Yugoslavia?
Professor.
Anyway, you get the general idea.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much. Professor, I am tone deaf.
You hear Oda?
That's a general idea about the success of the Music of Hal Roach Studios. And we would like to conclude now, ladies and gentlemen, with a medley of songs from Hal Roach Studios.
While down on a desert island, underneath the beauty of the stars, I strayed upon some maidens who were strumming on their guitars. A hula maid was dancing, and I knew I found a paradise. This is what I told her when I gazed into her eyes. Honolulu, baby, where'd you get those eyes? And a dark complexion, I just idolized. Honolulu, baby, where'd you get that smile? And the pretty red lips, and that sunny smile. When you start to dance, go to the trance, and then you shake it up and down. You shake a little here, you shake a little there. Well, you got the boys going to town. Honolulu, baby, sure know your stuff. Honolulu, baby, gonna call your bluff.
The idiot out here doesn't know when to stop. I'm in love with you, you great big hamburger, you.
We wanted to offer you something. And now... cinematic presentation for the evening?
When my dad was making chum at Oxford, he had a birthday. And Dick Courier and some of the people, or Jordan, put together some snippets for more or less, well, it was for our birthday present, but just sort of a nonsensical happening, and presented it to my father. And this is the only copy in existence. UCLA has a 35 mil but no sound. And they have been trying to get the soundtrack from us. And we've held out because I don't sing and I don't dance, but when I go somewhere I can take this film. So it's my claim to fame. Anyway, there is it's a very good possibility that next year the new treasures will be coming out with a cassette with Zenobia, some home movies of Zenobia that were taken by Meg Landon's family at Hal Roach Studio while they were making Zenobia, and possibly an interview with June Lyon and Harry Langdon Jr. And then on the back, also on this cassette, we will include That's That. So that might be available next year. You will see that this is, you know, it's just a sort of a put together, a little bit of this, a little bit of that. But everybody, much to our, at least to my amazement, everywhere I go, they want us to bring it. So you'll see it now. Jack's about ready to roll.
Almost.
Right?
Almost.
Almost. Okay. Oh, okay. And you'll notice some. Anyway, as I say, it seems to be just an intriguing thing. It doesn't make any sense. You'll notice bits and pieces from the film. And it's just a fun thing. And I hope you all enjoy it.
Ha ha ha!
Are you sure you're a Laurel? Sure? Why can't you see the family resemblance? Now that that's all settled, would it be asking too much if we had a look at the will? That will be attended to later, when we find out who murdered Ebenezer Laurel. Then the will won't be read tonight. No, not tonight. Well, goodbye. We'll see you later. Wait a minute. You'll stay right here. Why, you don't think we had anything to do with it, do you? I'm not saying, but I do believe that the criminal always returns to the scene of his crime.
These parts, and there's one thing we don't allow, and that's messing with our women.
We better go and get the deed. Say, maybe they won't give it back to us.
What do you mean they won't give it back to us? We'll get that deed, or I'll eat your hat.
If you don't eat that hat, I'll tie you to a tree and let the buzzards get you.
Would you really do that?
I certainly would. Eat it.
Well, I told you Toots to catch the next coach out of town.
Yes, sir.
Well, it left 10 minutes ago.
It did? Well, maybe we'd better try and catch it.
We'll get it.
I'll say you'd better find it.
Get the two.
two little boys from the California wilds are having the time of their lives seeing the sights of the big city. They're Laurel and Hardy, the famous laugh makers of the films, getting a crick in the neck giving the main stem the once-over. Broadway don't often see a sea-going hack plus a couple of movie stars, and the traffic cops are getting a headache. But these babies should worry about cops' whistles or red lights.
Pass that light up there.
Like a dream when I passed it, but if the light was red, I wouldn't blow the whistle for you to stop me.
Come on, up with the sidewalk.
You see, I rented this cab.
Well, just a minute. Sit in your cab there.
Up with the sidewalk.
Well, now, if you'll just pardon me just
now, go ahead. You're not driving. Here's the driver. I want to speak to him.
Well, I don't think the driver can talk. In fact, I don't think he can see.
I don't think he can see myself.
Oh, yeah, sure, you're right about it.
Pass that light.
What do you intend to do about it?
I intend to give him a ticket.
I thought you wanted to autograph it.
Just a moment, I'll take care of that autograph part of it.
Now, you see, officer, we're strangers to the city. We're going to give him a ticket. I think the best thing to do is not cost so much.
Now, I think the best thing you could do is get in there and sit in your cab.
Oh, I see. Well, yeah,
now, now if you don't, I'm going to lock the both of you up for interfering with an officer.
Now,
what's your name?
My name is John.
What's your last name?
Hardy. Oh, you weren't speaking to me, I see. And this is my friend, Mr. Laurel, over in the back seat. Just a moment, if you...
Here's your ticket for passing a light.
All right, I'll take it. Thank you very much, Mr. He'll take care of it, my friend. He takes care of all the business. Goodbye.